everybody. I'm Mary Margaret Funnell, and I'm the director of the School of Social Transformation at Arizona State University. And I want to welcome you to the Frank Lecture, which is a project of our Justice and Social Inquiry program in the school. And I'm going to start things off by introducing to you Karen Frank, who is going to say a few remarks on behalf of the Frank family.
Hi, I'm Karen Frank. It's my honor to welcome you on behalf of the Frank family, and I'm here today with my sister Gretchen and my niece Eva Lester. Eva actually is a graduate of the School of Social Transformation, and she now is so powerful in her job at the Buffett Foundation in Omaha that she got them to arrange to have a retreat here just in perfect timing. I know you're going to hear in a minute from Mary more about our speaker, but I just wanted to say that John would be so thrilled and honored to know that Nan Aron is the John Frank Lecturer. They were partners in crime and a number of very interesting campaigns, and he just admired you so much, and you know, your hard work and never giving up, even when it's so hard. So we're very lucky to have Nan here, and I know my dad would be thrilled. So thank you all for coming. Welcome, Nan. And okay.
She was joined on stage
by Arizona's Justice Andrea O'Connor and Chief Judge Mary Schroeder. And so this evening, it's really quite wonderful to have Chief Judge of the U.S. Courts of Appeals of the Ninth Circuit, Mary Schroeder. There's a lot of accolades. I could talk about her for a very, very long time, but I'll just say simply that she was the first woman associate at a major law firm in Arizona, hired by John Frank and Lewis and Rocha, now Lewis, Rocha, Rothgerber, and Christie. Many members of Lewis and Rocha are major donors for this event. I want to say thank you to each and every one of them. Mary Schroeder was also the author of the first Arizona law against sex-based employment discrimination, the first woman on the Arizona Court of Appeals, among, again, many contributions. Judge Mary Schroeder will introduce our guest speaker in further detail. I want to say a warm welcome to all of you who are part of the School of Social Transformation and those of you who are now friends of the School of Social Transformation. So welcome. It is really my pleasure and delight to be able to introduce Nan Aron to you tonight. After all, it's a night when everybody loves New York. Grew up in New York. She has a bachelor's degree from Oberlin and her JD from Case Western, but she was in Ohio for a while. And then she worked for the EEOC and for the ACLU. She did prison litigation. Her entire career has been marked by fights and battles on behalf of people who want equal opportunity and want to exercise their civil rights. It's really amazing. In 1979, she founded the Alliance for Justice, an organization, a consortium of about 100, more than 110 organizations, everything from the Humane Society to the AARP to the Sierra. And that organization fights for diversity on the bench. And many of you do not know this, but before Jimmy Carter became president of the United States, he was responsible for appointing me and a lot of other folks to the bench. There had only been two women who had ever served as federal appellate judges in the history of the United States. And now the federal bench is about 30% women. So only three women on the Supreme Court, which is just remarkable. And Nan has been a part of all of that history. She knows more than anybody else about judicial appointments. She runs courses for people who want to learn about running nonprofits because she does such a good job. She was, if any of you watched the movie, HBO movie Confirmation, it begins with a call from Nan Aron to the United States Senate. And I think more important, people like her. And I think that's how she gets along a lot. I've known her for more than 30 years, right? And I would say that even though she has fought so many battles, she's done so with such great patience and loyalty to her principles, and she is still one of the most liked people in D.C., and that's really quite unbelievable. And John Frank, as Karen has said, fought the world. So it is, and she is now going to bring us up to date on some current legal history. And I know that you're going to like it as much as all of your friends do. So with no further ado, Nan Aron.
Relatives
who live here in Phoenix, who are here with Finns, who are lawyers and judges. I thank them for being here only to make sure that I get some of your. So my topic tonight is the battle over the Supreme Court, politics or justice, which I'm going to use as an opportunity to talk about the current nomination fight, but also about the perception that the court and politics are now indistinguishable and how we got here. Now, while the lecture topic is the battle over the Supreme Court, politics or justice, I realize there's an implication that these are two irreconcilable concepts in opposition to each other. What I will explore is whether we can have both politics and justice, since the constitutional system itself deliberately combines them, and the current political climate thrusts them together, whether we like it or not. Now, I've been involved in the Alliance for Justice in dozens of hard-fought Supreme Court confirmation battles, both for and against candidates. And I've observed that court for well over four decades. And I've come to the conclusion that politics and justice cannot and should not be separated, but that lines can be crossed that take what is essential and valuable and transform it into something that's destructive and destabilizing. And that's what I want to talk about today. But before I begin, I would be remiss if I didn't mention the namesake of this event. I worked at Johnson for 2 decades at Alliance for Justice. I would say that John Fine adopted our office in Washington, given his interest in judicial selection. He also wanted a satellite office where he had no administrative obligations. That occurred to me a couple times. He mentored us at the Alliance, as many others, but more mentoring became a science, and people even looked for mentors. And of course, as we know, he was a fierce feminist who had the foresight to marry a wonderful woman, raise terrific children, and bring to his firm and the judiciary Mary Schroeder, who is a national treasure in the law. Even under normal circumstances, John Frank's life and work are the perfect source of inspiration for a lecture series about the law and justice, particularly in a school devoted to social transformation. But this year, his legacy is even more salient because we're in the middle of a titanic battle over the nomination of President Obama's selection of Merrick Garland. John's name on this lecture is perfect for two reasons. First, he was an active participant in several of the most politicized and contentious nominations in our history, including those of Clement Haynsworth, Robert Ford, and Clarence Thomas. The Garland controversy would be right up his alley. I doubt he'd be shocked by the politics of it, but I'd like to think he'd be appalled by the way it is played out, echoing the view, by the way, of most of the country. But the second reason is this nomination highlights the fact the causes for which he fought, including civil rights, women's rights, personal liberty, racial justice, equal justice, are all teetering on a knife's edge, waiting for this president and the next to appoint justices who will set the future direction of this court. This is one of those rare moments when the shift of one justice can have momentous implications. Even though Merrick Garland is moderate in his approach to the law, he would almost certainly represent a profound shift from the severely conservative views of Justice Scalia.
The New York Times recently conducted an analysis of the court's ideological makeup and determined that even if Garland becomes the court's conciliator, the middle itself will have shifted significantly to the left. In fact, the data showed that he would make the court the most liberal it's been in 50 years. That's not just a commentary on Garland, whose record is by any measure anything but extreme. Rather, it's really an indication of how far right Justice Scalia and his four conservative colleagues have been. And I remember an interview with Justice Stevens a day or two after he stepped down. And I remember the interviewer said, "Justice Stevens, is it true that you have become so liberal over these years?" And Justice Stevens said, "No, it's not that I became so liberal, it's that the court became so conservative." As I'm sure you know, the current vacancy aside, there are three remaining justices on the court who will be over 80 during the next president's term. There's an old aphorism from population studies that demography is destiny, but that's a concept that applies to the high court as well. There's no question whatsoever that the current fight is just the first of several looming in the future. If you like political conflict, you are in for a treat. The simple fact is that the future of the court depends entirely on the outcome of the next presidential election and the next few Senate elections. That alone makes politics and the Supreme Court one and the same. The bottom line is whoever is elected president this year will shape the direction and philosophy of the court for generations to come. In our system, the president serves 4 to 8 years. Supreme Court justices can stay for a lifetime, setting precedents that bind us for a generation. So, in a word, what's at stake? Everything. No matter which side you're on, the intensity of the current fight demonstrates what is unequivocally true. The future of the Supreme Court is the future of America. And unless you're prepared to argue that the nation's future should be determined without the input of the voters, then we have to conclude that politics and justice cannot and should not be separated. But that brings me back to the question at the heart of this lecture. What is the relationship between politics and the court, and what should it be? I think if you asked people whether they think the Supreme Court should be political, they would say no, of course not. In fact, we at Alliance for Justice commissioned a poll in 2012 in the middle of a legal fight over the Affordable Care Act, which found that 57% of the voters said they were extremely concerned that the court makes decisions based on a political agenda instead of the law. That's not really surprising. In the context of the Obamacare cases, which not only had massive political implications, no matter how they were decided, but were brought to the court to explicitly advance a particular policy outcome. I can't imagine a more political set of cases than the ones that have challenged and continue to challenge the healthcare law. People know that and respond accordingly. If it walks like politics, it quacks like politics, it's probably politics. And frankly, whether you think that's a good thing or probably not depends on how you feel about the outcome. I'll admit it's been rather amusing to watch conservatives and a host of presidential candidates, Republican presidential candidates, tear into Chief Justice John Roberts as if he were the second coming of William O. Douglas because of his role in the ACA case, which from the progressive side of things was a decidedly mixed bag. The criticisms of Roberts
statistical analysis in 2013 reviewed all the justices since World War II and found that Roberts was the second most business-friendly justice in our lifetimes, behind only Samuel Alito. This is what happens, though, when Supreme Court decisions are viewed through a political lens, which I would argue happens in almost all the big cases. Blockbuster cases are almost always tinged by politics, not because they just affect a core legal or constitutional principle, or because they target or trigger partisan political responses, because they profoundly shape people's lives or strike at core personal values. In our democracy, those values, those concerns, those deep human responses are expressed through politics and all of its many permutations. And that's not a bad thing. That's our system. And the system kicks in when the president chooses a nominee. Article 2, Section 2, Paragraph 2 of the Constitution makes the nomination and confirmation process for Supreme Court justices inherently political. One political actor, the president, has to get approval from another set of political actors, the Senate, in order to put someone on the court. Any process that requires that kind of enforced interaction among politicians, many of whom will be in opposition to each other, is automatically political. The polite term we use in civics classes is checks and balances, but what it really means is hardcore politics. The justices, though, believe otherwise. Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who is one of my heroes, said in an interview in 2011 that, quote, "What I care most about, I think most of my colleagues do too, is that we want this institution to maintain the position that it has had in the system, where it is not considered a political branch of government." Chief Justice Roberts recently gave a speech where he said, quote, "Please don't politicize us. Don't talk about us as if we were chess pieces, because what we do transcends that." Unfortunately for these two justices, that horse may have already left the barn. But what is undeniable is that the process that put them both on the court is assuredly very political and must be so. And I say that as someone who has spent my career fully engaged in the political tug of war over federal judicial nominations at all levels. And as Mary said, over the weekend, many of you might have seen this film, Confirmation, about the Hill Clarence Thomas hearings. And yes, it was me who picked up the phone and called an aide, Ricky Seidman, to Senator Kennedy and said, "Hey, Ricky, it's me at Alliance for Justice. I need to talk to you about a person who may have been sexually harassed by Judge Thomas." So obviously, it would be hard for me to argue that there's no place for politics in confirmation. Everyone pretends to be outraged that Supreme Court nominations are politicized, but I can promise you that no one in Washington really believes that. Of course it's political, the founders set it up that way, but even more importantly, the American people understand that their lives are profoundly affected by what these justices do, and they insist on the right to get involved in the process of picking them. I think that's especially true now and has been for a long time. And none of this is new. But I should say, in this highly partisan age, everything now is put through an ideological and political filter. So once the court becomes an issue for voters, the pressure for the political class to enforce specific ideologies increases. You can see this now at work in the context of the Garland nomination. tremendous pressure from ultra-conservative constituents, the conservative media, the Koch brothers, and their colleagues not to cave in to Democratic demands that they schedule a hearing and a vote. Even long-serving senators are kept in line by threats of facing primary opponents or a barrage of media criticism. Look at poor Lisa Murkowski, the senator from Alaska. She said on February 17th that Merrick Garland should get a hearing. Then on February 18th, she was tweeting that only the next president should go to see. You can get whiplash watching this stuff. And unfortunately, your own senators here in Arizona are part of this theater of the absurd. You'll recall that John McCain was part of the bipartisan gang of 14 that invoked high-minded intra-party cooperation to grease the nominations of John Roberts and Samuel Alito through a Democratic Senate. Now, he's unwilling to even let a legitimate, highly qualified, moderate nominee get a hearing, let alone a vote. I have to admit, I don't know what to say about Jeff Flake. On the one hand, he met with Judge Garland last week and has said that if Hillary Clinton wins the election, the Senate should go ahead and consider Garland, whom he called a centrist figure, and deal with him in the lame duck rather than take a chance on a more liberal nominee later on. On the other hand, Senator Flake recently quoted saying, quote, "My theory is we ought to pick the most conservative jurors we can to replace Justice Scalia to maintain the balance of the court. But the principle that the next president should decide is not one that I share. First, I'm not sure how maintaining an ideological majority meets the dictionary definition of balance. And second, I have no idea what he means when he says the next president shouldn't decide who is nominated to the court. Is he perhaps suggesting a lottery system? If it didn't have such serious implications, it would be a bit entertaining to watch senators twist themselves into a rhetorical pretzel in order to justify the unjustifiable. But if politics is part of the nomination process and is a necessary component of American democracy, why are people on my side of this battle so upset about the refusal of Senate leadership to hold a hearing and give Garland a vote? After all, aren't McCain and Flake just political actors in a political process, just as the founders intended? The answer is no, it's not the same. The Republicans have justified their obstruction of Garland by saying that the decision needs to be deferred until after the election so that the people can weigh in. They won't give the hearing and certainly not a vote. But even the most controversial nominees, including Robert Bork and Clarence Thomas, had hearings, contentious though they were. They even had final floor votes, in spite of the fact that the Democrats controlled the Senate. Bork lost, Thomas was narrowly confirmed. Those were intense political nominations and were part of an intensely political process. I still have the scars to prove it, as do many people on all sides. You can argue about fairness, you can argue about outcomes, you can argue about the bitterness of the conflict and whether things have become better or worse since. But the process, as messy as it was, occurred in the context of the American democratic system as the founders set it up, and its passion matched the enormity of the stakes. But what's happening today with Merrick Garland is distinctly anti-democratic. The Republican leadership is turning its back on the system the founders established. The President of the United States is required to make appointments to the court, and the Senate provides advice and consent. Yes, elections have consequences, and yes, the Supreme Court should be a major campaign issue. We have been advocating precisely that for decades. But the relevant election has already taken place. It happened in 2012 at Barack Obama won. He gets to make the nomination. To say otherwise is to deny the legitimacy of the last presidential election, disenfranchise the 66 million people who voted for him, and to unilaterally truncate the president's term of office to 3 years. That is not democracy. That's not politics as it's supposed to be played. If Republicans are concerned about Merrick Garland, they should hold hearings, ask him questions, listen to his answers, and vote their conscience on the floor of the Senate in full view of the American people. What's happening now is way out of bounds and substantively different from what's happened in previous confirmation fights, even the most contentious. I don't know how the Garland fight will end. I've learned in politics never to make a prediction. Perhaps public pressure and the fear of losing the Senate will be enough to force an end to the madness. But let's face reality. This is just the first opening on the court. These conflicts are only going to get more intense as the political environment becomes more polarized. And this is where I worry about things crossing a line into full-fledged dysfunction. Already, some Republicans are making noises about not confirming any Democratic appointees, no matter what happens in the next election. Judiciary Committee Chairman Chuck Grassley wrote an op-ed last week in the Des Moines Register where he argued that the court really doesn't need 9 justices. Oh. But what if the next president is a Republican? What will confirmation battles look like then? We have some clues. Two conservative legal scholars, Randy Barnett from Georgetown and Josh Blackman from the South Texas College of Law, wrote an article last fall in the Weekly Standard called, quote, The Next Justices. They noted the advancing ages of several of them and concluded, the next president will likely have the opportunity to appoint a replacement for 1, 2, 3, or maybe 4. Their decisions will reshape the court. Now, I don't usually agree with much of what these guys have to say, but they are absolutely right about them. But it's what they write next that is telling, or should I say chilling, and which tells us where the nomination process for the Supreme Court justices is heading. The article spells out what they think conservatives should do if a future Republican president gets to fill Supreme Court seats. They begin by calling for the most ideologically pure nomination possible. And if what they call a contentious nomination fails, then try again. They say, and I quote, bruising confirmation battles are worth the political capital for a lifetime appointment. In their view, if a board gets turned down, find another one just like them. They call for the rejection of what they term cliched calls for judicial restraint. They write, quote, presidential candidates should reject the vapid labels of restraint and legislating from the bench, and focus instead on what a prospective nominee's proven track record and paper trail say about his constitutional philosophy. The heart of the inquiry should be whether the nominee is willing to engage and enforce the Constitution against the other branches, not whether they can parrot cliches about strict constructionism or calling balls and strikes during a confirmation hearing. Their litmus test for potential justices revolves around originalism. which sounds like another one of those cliches to me, but which they define as adhering to the original meaning of the text of the Constitution, each and every word. Now, some of you might actually agree with these professors, but I quote their words to make clear the simple fact that the nomination and confirmation process is destined to become even more political than ever. And if you think the political fights and the confirmation fights of the past three decades have been uncomfortable, you haven't seen anything new. Especially if vacancies start opening up in significant numbers. I don't think it's excessively partisan to point out that on the right-wing base of the Republican Party, there is an intensity, a passion about the court. I've been excited ever since the Garland nomination to see the level of interest among progressives that's emerged since his nomination, which helped clarify the stakes in a way that almost nothing could. The pressure from the right to promote hardcore conservatives to the court and to oppose virtually anyone put forward by a Democratic president cannot be overstated. But traditionally, the reverse is not quite as true. It's true that opposition from the left to Bork and Thomas, and to a lesser extent, Alito was significant, but Scalia and Kennedy were confirmed unanimously, and Roberts had 78 votes. I think this has to do with the way conservatives and progressives view the courts, and that difference has shaped the framework for Supreme Court nominations and its decisions. Movement conservatives see the courts as instruments of political power. Progressives see the courts as instruments of justice. Think the Supreme Court decisions of Brown versus Board of Education, Roe versus Wade, encouraged a voting public, a very strong voting public, to turn against the court. That was decades ago. There were bumper stickers on cars in the South after the Brown case, calling for the impeachment of Earl Warren. That base of the Republican Party was growing still. And the decision Engel versus Vitale that ended school prayer angered religious voters so much that they became part of an ever-growing, ever-expanding group on the right. But there is another phenomenon that has led to this transformation to the conservative side. And that takes place in 1971 with a memo written by Lewis Powell to the Chamber of Commerce to counter what he considered to be attacks on the American free enterprise system. He spelled out a strategy for business interests to gain greater sway over the education system, universities, the media, and the political branches of government. It was, in many ways, a blueprint for what has happened since, the emergence of a powerful conservative influence that has embedded itself in every aspect of American life. Without doubt, his memo was an extraordinarily influential document that resonates today. He called for the creation of a kind of intellectual infrastructure on the right. And soon afterward, groups like the Heritage Foundation, the American Legislative Exchange Council, and the Federal Society were born. He called for aggression and he got it. He wrote, there should not be the slightest hesitation to press vigorously in all political arenas support of the enterprise system, nor should there be reluctance to penalize those who oppose it. But one part of that memo is of special interest to us, and that relates to the court. In the section he called Neglected Opportunity in the Courts, he something that is completely true. He says, under our constitutional system, especially with an activist-minded Supreme Court, the judiciary may well be the most important instrument for social, economic, and political change. Howell then complains that the left has been much more successful in using the law to achieve its ends, citing labor unions, civil rights groups, the ACLU, and public interest firms as the bad guys. He calls on big business to fight back. And that's what's going to happen. You can draw a line from the blockbuster cases of the Warren and Berger errors to the work of confirmation ballots, the squashing by right-wing forces of George Bush's nomination of Harriet Myers, the demonization of John Roberts in this year's election, the 7 years of massive obstruction of President Obama's judicial nominations, and the current refusal for the Senate to confirm Merrick Garland. Now, I should mention that in Washington, the current endless season of political campaigning has given way from time to time to a bit of humor. And I love what Vice President Biden says that he related to Barack Obama. Biden says, he says, Barack, if you really want to reshape the court, why don't you nominate Ted Cruz? That way, you won't just have one vacancy, you'll have all. So, what happens when the political and ideological fights continue past the nomination process and onto the courts? We know that the court and the justices themselves have agendas. They bring with them to the court the agendas that nurtured their careers, push them to the top of their selection list, shaped their personal legal philosophies, and got them to the confirmation finish line, of course. They don't just come from the mystical realm. We don't recruit judges and justices from monasteries. In fact, many of them have worked as active participants in presidential administration. Roberts worked for Ronald Reagan. Elena Kagan worked for Barack Obama. And why not? I think it's a good thing for judges to have spent time in the real world. The classic example of this is Arizona's own Sandra Day O'Connor, who famously was a state senator before becoming a state judge and eventually a justice on the Supreme Court. She was a politician, and that was a good thing. And so now, given the time, I am going to skip a little bit of this to my conclusion. The authority of the Supreme Court and acceptance of the rule of law itself depends on a belief that cases are heard fairly, equitably, and that everyone who enters a courtroom has a fighting chance for justice. When that trust falters and the public feels that outcomes are predetermined by ideology or partisan affiliation, or the powerful forces receive preferential treatment, the foundations of our legal system start to crash. Alexis de Tocqueville wrote 175 years ago that there is scarcely, hardly a political question in the United States which does not sooner or later turn into a judicial one. Today, the reverse is also true. There is hardly a major judicial decision that doesn't quickly become political. That's the world we live in. The country's divided. Passions are high. The Supreme Court makes decisions that profoundly affect the rights we have, the way we live, the shape of our society. That's why the fight over Merrick Garland is so intense, and why the next vacancy and the next one after that will be even more so. This lecture asks the question of whether the battle over the Supreme Court represents politics or I hope it represents both. Our democracy requires the passionate, informed involvement of all of us. People have the right to care about the court and to act accordingly. I have fought many battles over the direction of the court, and I expect to fight many more. The American constitutional system is designed to allow political considerations to influence the selection of justices and, by extension, the shape of the law. But in the end, it's up to all of us. We in this room know how critically important the Supreme Court and our federal courts are in influencing over every aspect of our life in this wonderful country. And at this particular moment in time, I ask each of us in this room to stand up for justice, to stand up to our senators who refuse to treat a Supreme Court nominee with fairness. We need to press them, we need to call on them, we need to follow them, we need to target them. They need to schedule a vote for Merrick Garland and to preserve our court, not just for the country and our democracy. Yes, politics and law are inseparable, but their constructive coexistence depends on restraint, responsibility, and a deep and abiding respect for both. John Frank's work and life in the law was an inspiring example of those values. Thank you very much.
I want you to pretend like you're a fly on the wall in the lame duck session of the U.S. Senate should we have a Democrat take the presidency. What's that going to be like?
Well, I think it in part it depends on what happens in the Senate, too.
Yeah.
Right? For sure, if we take the Senate, the Democrats take it. Well, I think race has been a factor for Republicans. But I also think that the main reason that Republicans don't want to give Nan Aron a hearing is because they want to make the issue about Barack Obama. They do not want to make the issue about Merrick Garland. And we've all seen hearings, right, on TV of Supreme Court justices. And, you know, each side wants to portray their own candidate in the most sympathetic, empathetic way. I mean, they even got Samuel Alito's wife to cry during his hearing. But I think Republicans are scared that the focus would be shifted from a president to Garland, who is very soft-spoken, incredibly polite, measured. I don't think they want the cameras on his spouse, his two children, his family. So I think they've got it right where they've got it. Right where they want it. I do think they want the focus to be on the president. Yeah. It is reckless. Anything else?
Yeah. So throughout your lecture, you mentioned kind of shifting the decision of a Supreme Court justice from like a political aspect more into like a democracy. Where the people vote for their Supreme Court justice or have a say in that. Like, how would you think the government would go about incorporating citizens into the vote of the Supreme Court justice?
I think it's how do you.
He won the question. Repeat the question.
Put forth someone who was like more appealing.
I was wondering if you would support that action as a candidate.
Well, I think Hillary Clinton said that she would renominate, she would support Merrick Garland. I think in large part, well, that kind of fits with her, I think, view of how things happen. But her husband, remember, appointed Merrick Garland to the D.C. Circuit. So I think she would reappoint if elected. Bernie Sanders said something pretty peculiar, which is he said he would not appoint Merrick Garland. I don't know why he said that, but I don't know a lot of things. So I also don't like what either of them says when they talk about the courts. Both Democratic candidates have said, I will look for Supreme Court justices that who will overturn Citizens United.
Yeah.
And I have never been a supporter or proponent of litmus tests of any kind on the right and now on the left. Plus, who in America, besides us in this room, knows what Citizens United is? I just don't know. So I don't think that's a healthy thing, and I think candidates actually have an awesome opportunity to help educate people about what justices do, what courts do, and so we will be doing our best to educate the Republican and Democratic candidates as to how they, and I'm sure the Republican candidates will be very interested in what we have to say, but we will be
I had a friend who worked for me, immigrated from another country, and told me one of the great things about the United States was its court system. He wasn't just talking about criminal courts, and I was quite impressed that he thought that was so important. I just didn't think someone would look at that if they were from somewhere else. So my question is to you, probably with your 501c4, Anna, do you see in the course of the politicization, or what people see the politicization of the courts, to be a decline of respect? We get polls all the time about the president's acceptance, the Congress acceptance, it's always in the toilet. What about the court system's acceptance among people in America? Is it gone down or up? Is it related to some of these battles?
Their acceptance of the public's acceptance of the courts is really dependent on what's happening in the country you went on. But I would say at the moment, the public feels that the courts play a really important role. It's interesting. We usually poll right after a major political event, hoping to exploit it in some way. For instance, after Bush v. Gore, the decision which you all know, Bush v. Gore selected the George W. Bush as president, people had a very high view of the court. I was like dumbstruck. I couldn't believe it. I thought, what's going on? I also think, and this is very regrettable, I don't think people think about the court much. I don't think they have a view. I don't think people, I know this, that most Americans don't think they are entitled, smart enough, knowledgeable enough to even have a view about courts and what they do. And it probably goes back to what Justice O'Connor's been trying to do in the teaching of civics, but I don't know that many people, it even crosses their minds. I'm thinking a poll that we just did, though, right after Scalia's death and before Garland's nomination, told us a few interesting things at that moment. And that's why I say it's very much dictated by the time. 80% of the people that we polled, this was Jeff Garin and Guy Molyneux from Peter Hart Research, 80% of the people polled say they were following the Supreme Court closely. The vast majority said they wanted the president to nominate someone, and an equal number said they wanted the Senate to hold a hearing and give fair consideration. And if
nominations of the lower court, federal court judges, that where there's not as much usually publicity and attention as there is on the Supreme Court. I know Garland is perceived, you said, centrist or moderate. How would you characterize the rest of President Obama's nominations?
That's a good question.
I'm related to you.
I guess so I will say this. I think he's appointed stellar judges to the federal bench. Incredibly well qualified. I'd say moderate in your views. I would say Merrick Garland is probably emblematic of the kind of nominee that the president is appointed to the lower court. He is not chosen to appoint, I would say, any of the intellectual icons on the left, just over our protestations. Mm-hmm. And the other thing I would say is, I am looking forward to the next Democrat in the White House giving much more consideration to public interest lawyers, legal services lawyers, public defenders, a diversity of professional experience. I think something like 87% of the judges confirmed Obama judges have been prosecutors. And you know what? I don't know, Mary, if this is your experience, but I've had judges say to me that when at the Court of Appeals level, when you're arguing a case between three former prosecutors and you're a criminal defendant, you don't have a chance. You don't have a chance. So I do think we need much more professional diversity, and it's a point that we have impressed upon the White House. I personally would have loved to have seen the president appoint Jane Kelly. Jane Kelly is a judge on the Eighth Circuit Court of Appeals, but for her entire career has been a public defender. How wonderful would that have been to have a public defender as a Supreme Court justice? But the minute her name appeared on the short list, a right-wing group funded by the Koch brothers ran Amos in several states in the country, and she was removed from the short list.